Muy buenas noches, soy Tatiana Medina, directora de la Escuela Profesional de Arquitectura y Urbanismo de la Universidad Católica San Pablo. En nombre de la Pontificia Universidad Javeriana de Bogotá, Colombia, la Universidad de Newcastle de Australia, la Universidad Católica del Norte y del Departamento de Arquitectura e Ingeniería de Construcción de la Universidad Católica San Pablo, miembros del proyecto COALAR, les doy la más cordial bienvenida a la conferencia Introducción al Building Information Modeling en el Perú, perspectivas en el campo de la construcción. Agradecemos a todas las personas que nos están acompañando en este evento mediante la plataforma de Zoom. A su vez, indicarles que pueden seguirnos a través de Facebook y el canal de YouTube de la Universidad Católica San Pablo. Para dar inicio, invito a la magíster Paola Vicente Chocano, oficial de Economía y Diplomacia Pública de la Embajada de Australia, quien nos brindará unas palabras. Adelante, por favor. Hola, por favor, tu micro está apagado.
Ah, ¿qué tal? Hola, buenas tardes a todos. Comienzo nuevamente. Soy Paola Vicente, de la Embajada de Australia. Muchísimas gracias por la invitación de abrir esta conferencia. Quisiera empezar saludándolos en nombre de la embajadora Diana Nelson. Ella no ha podido estar presente esta tarde, pero les manda sus saludos. Y también saludar al doctor Carlos Ceballos Velarde, decano de la Facultad de Ingeniería y Computación de la Universidad Católica San Pablo, que se encuentra presente. Asimismo a ti, Tatiana, muchísimas gracias por la invitación. El seminario de hoy, Introducción al Building Information Modeling en el Perú, como ya lo mencionó Tatiana, es parte de un programa de desarrollo de habilidades para mujeres en América Latina, que busca su recuperación económica a través de la construcción. Este es un proyecto financiado por COALAR, es el Consejo para las Relaciones Australia-Latinoamérica, y en el Perú está liderado por la Universidad de Newcastle, de Australia, y la Universidad Católica San Pablo. Es inevitable comentar que el desarrollo profesional de las mujeres y su acceso a la economía siempre ha presentado retos, inclusive antes de la pandemia. Y ahora con la pandemia, pues todos estos retos y todas estas fortalezas y estas áreas por mejorar, pues todas se han incrementado más, ¿no? De manera exponencial, los retos y sobre todo las áreas por mejorar. Y por eso, para la Embajada de Australia, proyectos como este ayudan mucho a facilitar la independencia económica de más mujeres a través de la educación, el entrenamiento y el empleo. Desde nuestro trabajo en el Perú, hemos venido promoviendo proyectos que impulsan el acceso y liderazgo de las mujeres en sectores tradicionalmente manejados por hombres. Por ejemplo, la minería, ¿no? Nosotros somos grandes aliados de un grupo de mujeres mineras que se llaman Women in Mining Perú. Es una asociación que se ha formado hace 5 años y con la que venimos trabajando el fortalecimiento del liderazgo de las mujeres en estos sectores tradicionalmente liderados por hombres, ¿no? Y, por supuesto, estamos muy felices de ver una iniciativa como la de hoy, una iniciativa como la que tienen, en que se enfoquen, ¿no? Se están enfocando en otro sector tradicionalmente liderado por hombres, como es la construcción. Nosotros creemos que la apuesta por brindarle a las mujeres más herramientas técnicas y profesionales no solo aliviará sus economías y las de sus familias, sino que también ayudará a desarrollar nuestro sector construcción. Yo solo quería darles el saludo a la embajadora de Australia en una participación breve para felicitarlos por la iniciativa, felicitar a las participantes, a las panelistas que se encuentran presentes hoy. No quiero dejar de agradecer al equipo de la Universidad de Newcastle, compuesto por Temi Ekpel-Lakin y Sandra Carrasco, por involucrar a la Embajada de Australia en esta iniciativa. Muchísimas gracias. Y, por supuesto, al equipo de la contraparte peruana, la Universidad Católica San Pablo, representados esta noche por el doctor Ceballos y por la magíster Tatiana Medina. Solo muchísimas gracias nuevamente. Éxitos y y pensar que esto es un proyecto totalmente necesario y urgente, ¿no? De ver más mujeres participando en el sector construcción. Los felicito a todos por esta iniciativa. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Paola, por darnos estas palabras de fuerza para poder seguir en proyectos tan interesantes como esto y valorando el trabajo que realizan las mujeres. Muy bien, a continuación invito al doctor.
Invite doctor Carlos Ceballos Velarde.
Clínica San Pablo, quien nos hablará acerca del proyecto Coalar. Adelante, por favor.
Coalar Project. We seem to be experiencing issues, technical issues.
Lo que está pasando, pero bueno, ahí seguiremos avanzando.
We'll try to fix these technical difficulties.
Proyecto.
Hola, ¿me escuchan?
Ahora sí, Carlitos, sí. Ahora
gracias.
Sí.
Ha sido un día realmente complicado.
It's been a very complicated day. I've been trying to get into the room for 20 minutes, but I'm finally here. First of all, I'd like to welcome our friends that are here with us. This is a very special occasion. The Universidad Católica San Pablo is organizing one of the events that are part of the COALAR project, a project led by the University of Newcastle of Australia, and it also comes with the participation of the Pontificia Universidad Católica del Norte de Chile and the Pontificia Universidad Javeriana, Colombia. This is a very special project. This project has a really noble purpose. It tries to give equal opportunities for everybody, so the women have possibilities to expand their activities, especially in the construction field. And to do that, it uses digital development tools. One of those digital tools is the BIM methodology, the Building Information Modeling methodology, that allows us to assemble and create a 3D model of a building where different specialists can work together in a collaborative energy effort. In the Universidad Católica San Pablo, we have several experiences with this methodology. And next, you're going to listen to our professors speaking about such experiences. Being a digital tool, it It doesn't matter who's using such tool. So it also allows us to move up and find a way to use BIM in more integrated ways. It can allow women to be a part of the construction industry nowadays. We thank the Kohler Foundation to give us the opportunity to work in this project. So that's all I have to say. Thank you for your attention.
Invito a hacer uso de la palabra a la magistra.
Thank you, Dr. Carlos. Next, I invite Cecilia Schack, who's going to present, who's going to give us a presentation to introduction to BIM worldwide and in Peru. Hi, good night with everybody. I'd like to thank everybody for their participation. I'd like to talk about my experience with the BIM methodology, why I think now we are entering a stage where not just women, but everybody in construction is going to be able to use this type of methodology and also use the tools that are already in the market.
Perfecto. Entonces, explicarles un poquito los fundamentos.
I would like to explain the BIM fundamentals. What is BIM? What do we use it for? BIM means Building Information Modeling. And it is referred to all the information that traditionally we presented in the blueprints, in the computer of the civil engineer, the architect, the project manager, the contractor, but now in this methodology, everything is linked in a single 3D model. According to the architect Johann Hudwalker, BIM is based in the use of 3D digital models that represent the different elements of a building or infrastructure and their relationship with each other, which allows to understand the building as a system and that contains relevant information that can be used by all the parties along its life cycle. The stages are planning, design, construction, operation, maintenance, and these are available for all the stakeholders that work in a collaborative and concurrent way. So everything in the building is integrated. What the architect thinks, what the client expects, everything is integrated in a single model. So this allows us to have a broad vision of the life cycle process of a construction. The usual process is planning, design, construction, operation, and maintenance. It's not just design and construction. we have to see the whole life cycle of the project. And the most interesting thing is the capability, the methodology to work together, to work collaboratively. This is one of the principles of the methodology. So here I present you the traditional scheme, the traditional way of doing things. Here we can see the designer that has an idea of the project. And then we also have the project manager that receives the information but has a different interpretation. And we also have the contractor who also receives the information but has a different idea than the project manager and the original designer. That's why we have all the typical issues that we find in a construction project, where the deadlines and the costs are never fulfilled. That's because the idea wasn't always shared completely. So this methodology allows us to relate all these concepts and all these experiences and integrate them in a single project, in a single 3D model. We create this 3D model that has everything integrated and that works in a bi-directional way. So nothing is hidden. Everybody knows what the project consists of. Everybody can access the information, and this gives a lot of value for the project, because as we know, two heads think better than one. So we can have more precise information and therefore make better decisions. We can make decisions before we build. Therefore, the project is going to flow much faster. Obviously, in a project, we will always have problems. There are always going to be things that we may not expect and will not be able to anticipate. But this methodology allows us to manage them more efficiently. And also, this methodology allows us to anticipate them. BIM also has changed the way we usually think and act in traditional projects. And that's because in BIM, everybody works together. We all work collaboratively. Therefore, this methodology feels more natural. The workflow feels also more natural. Well, but with BIM, it also comes a bit more effort. And the effort comes in the way of the need to have a more fluid communication. Working with BIM doesn't necessarily mean that we are going to forget about blueprints. You can also use them, but now all that information, all those information in the blueprints is related to the digital model. And not only the graphical information, but also the non-graphical information. BIM gives us a lot of benefits. It usually took me a lot of time to work in a project, and by using the BIM methodology, I have been able to reduce the time for design in the fourth or third part of the original time. And by reducing the time, the cost will also be lower. So this is a really big benefit for the client and also for the designer. After this, I'm going to show you a really short clip that explains how to model me, how to describe it. And the thing with BIM is that we can also use it for calculating the energy efficiency of a building, And that's a really relevant topic nowadays. Yeah, the potential of BIM for communication increases and improves the rhythm of the project. It allows for everybody to participate together and gain information in real time. So give me a second, I'm going to try to show a clip. There it is. This is the interface of the software Autodesk Revit. It's one of the most commercial or the most popular softwares for the BIM methodology. This software allows us to work in 2D as well as 3D simultaneously. As you can see, we are building a home here. We can model in 3D or also on a 2D view. We can create sections, we can create elevation views, we can also create the blueprints for the project, we can change or use different levels of information, levels of detail as well. So it gives us a lot of freedom in design. So for me, it was way easier maybe to use this project or this type of software for my projects in the university. And it also it is also a really ecological alternative because it doesn't use any real material. It's just that everything is designed in a computer, so we don't use paper, we don't use any other physical tool. And as you see, it's pretty easy to design a simple house like this with very few steps, and the design process is significantly faster and more precise. And as we know also, having a 3D model is really attractive for a client. A client that maybe doesn't know anything about the construction industry. And having this type of information, this 3D model, allows the client to understand the project and therefore being closer to guarantee their satisfaction with the project. You can also see that we can assign materials, right? We have a really vast library of components as well. You can see that we can assign material for the terrain. You can also include vegetation. We can create using perspective as well. We can also create render images as well. So it is a really powerful tool. I'd like to finish my presentation talking about an initiative in Peru that is trying, that is that has the goal to implement BIM in Peru, and it's called the Plan BIM Peru. We have been using in Peru this methodology since 2010. But it has mainly been used by the private sector. With this initiative, where the Peruvian government aims to insert the BIM methodology also in the public sector. So we are getting ready to work together, public and private sector, as well as the academy. And here I give you a link to the Ministry of Economy and Finance of Peru, so you can check out the Plan BIM Peru. I believe this is a tool that, according to my experience, is going to be really useful. I think this is going to change the way we think. It's going to allow us to enter into the digital era. And that's it. I hope you have has been interesting to you. Thanks a lot.
Ahora vamos a continuar.
Thank you, Cecilia. So now we're going to continue with Karen. Karen's presentation is about her experience in BIM and the Plan BIM in Peru. Good evening to everybody. Thanks to the Universidad Católica San Pablo for the invitation.
Bueno, el tema que yo voy a tratar es la implementación de BIM en el Perú. Ya
I'm going to talk about the implementation of BIM in Peru. Cecilia has already talked a bit about this. Since 2019, the Peruvian government has been promoting this plan, Peru. So I'm going to talk about the progress in this plan, and also the challenges that we are facing to implement plan. We want this methodology to be also sustainable in time. And in order to achieve that, we have to work in certain aspects. First, I'm going to talk about the progress in the public sector. This is a timeline for the Plan BIM Peru. In 2019, the Plan Nacional de Competitividad and Productividad, or the Competitiveness and Productivity National Plan, was published. And what it says is that the BIM methodology must be or must start be implemented in the public sector? And why does the government look at BIM and aims to implement it in the public sector? It's mainly because many of the files in the public sector have several issues, several problems that finally lead to additional cost and additional time to the project. And so the government realized that if we kept working the way we did, we weren't going to solve such problems. So BIM was looked at the alternative to deal with these issues. This is the context where this plan was developed. So in 2020, this decree was published that settled the roadmap for the adoption of BIM in the public sector. And in 2021, two standards and requirements have already been published for the BIM methodology in Peru. And these standards set the rules for any project that would like to take part in the tenders for projects in the public sector. Also for this year, the goal is to start generating capabilities in participants of this industry. For 2025, we also would like to include the use of BIM, not just for the public sector. We also would like to implement a technological platform that can be a hub for the information managed by the government in regards to BIM. In this platform, you could find libraries for materials, for families as well, in Revit. So in this platform, you could download all this information, and this will allow the projects in Peru to be standardized. For 2030, the goal of the plan is to make the use of BIM mandatory for any project or every project in the public sector. So this the road to 2030 is really close, so it's really important that everybody in the industry is involved in, with this methodology, because it is already being, or it is being a, or it is a, already a requirement. Everybody in the industry must already know at least what BIM is.
Porque justamente marcan cómo es que se va a gestionar la información del modelo.
In this slide, I show you the different documents that have been promoted regarding the use or implementation of the BIM methodology in Peru.
Alguna interferencia, ¿no? La idea es tomar decisiones antes de. Entonces, el tema de la gestión de información es muy importante. ¿Cómo se va a gestionar esa información? Para eso, este año.
Because it allows us to make decisions. Regarding the information management, this year, INACAL has promoted two standards. The standard, which is the ISO 19650, sets or adapts this international standard to the Peruvian context. What we have also done in this year is publishing a BIM guide for Peru. This document sets the responsibilities and the different roles of the people involved in a project that uses the BIM methodology. So it is important that we are already getting involved in this. And it is also very important that the academia also gets involved in this process. Engineers, civil engineers and architects must develop these skills. These standards, ISO 19650, have been translated and adapted to our reality. And the entity in charge of that has been INACAL. INACAL is the Institute for Quality in Peru. We also have the National BIM Guide. This document tells us how we're going to manage the information in the model. And we also have this technical note of introduction to BIM. That's going to set or give basic definitions. So if you don't have, or if we don't have many skills or knowledge, we can go through that, or we can check that note.
La implementación de la metodología BIM en las intervenciones que está desarrollando la autoridad, ¿no? Entonces ya tenemos proyectos que están desarrollando o se están desarrollando bajo esta metodología, ¿no? Lo que mencionan acá en esta nota que
we already have some projects that have been using this methodology. And we have achieved this by signing an agreement with the United Kingdom. And it is already showing positive results. Also, the Ministry of Transports and Communication has already implemented a BIM room that is used for the roads, infrastructure projects that are being developed. And this is just the start of the use of the methodology in the public sector. In regards of the private sector, this year, a study of BIM adoption in building projects in Lima and Callao has been published this study has been made in 2017, but the results were published this year. As you can see, around 40% of the projects that consisted on buildings in urban areas in Lima and Callao used the BIM methodology, and 60% didn't use it. We can also see that if we divide the enterprises that used the BIM methodology, and we divide them in three sectors of small, micro, and middle scale. Usually, the middle scale enterprises use more BIM than the micro one. Yeah, so you can see that the micro and small companies don't really use BIM that much as the medium-sized companies. This is because implementing the BIM methodology requires the commitment of the whole organization. And these small companies don't have the basic resources to accomplish this. But we can also see that there is a progressive increase of the use of the methodology. Nevertheless, this shows us the need to boost the use of the methodology in the whole industry. This study, also, the persons that used the methodology were asked what did they think were the benefits of using or adopting the BIM methodology. And most of them say that using the BIM methodology increases or enhances the quality of the information. It also enhances the overall quality of the project. It increases the definition of the project as well.
Mejora de la calidad del proyecto, y también mencionan que hay una reducción considerable en el tiempo de construcción y en el costo, ¿no? Entonces, podemos ver que...
Another conclusion is that there is a significant reduction on the cost of the overall project, as well as the time of the total execution of the project. So, what challenges does this implementation process face? Well, if we could focus on the academy, there is a need to change the curriculum of the universities that has programs in the AEC industry. This change in the curriculum must aim to develop soft skills, technical knowledge, and digital competence. The academia must also be a space to develop research around BIM. Why do we need soft skills? Well, because BIM is a collaborative process. If we only have technical skills, technical knowledge, but we are not able to communicate efficiently, then the methodology will be of little use. The technical knowledge is also important. The experience in constructive procedures is very important. Building a digital model is like building twice. So I need that experience in order to have the basic notions of the process. There are several software that work in the BIM methodology. Revit is just one of them. So we must
¿cómo perciben la educación BIM en el mercado? ¿No? Actualmente, ¿cómo están los profesionales que están
interesados? So the companies in the industry were asked, how do you perceive the BIM methodology is present in the market? And their answers were that some universities teach BIM, and only around 60% of the engineering and architecture graduates know something about BIM. It also says that many of the subjects that cover BIM are only focused on 3D modeling, and a lower percentage is focused on collaborative flows. So with these results, we can conclude that the BIM methodology is a great opportunity for our industry. So the other point is in regards to the AEC industry. Nowadays, we work individually. There's a high level of fragmentation in the industry. And that's because of the way we are used to design and communicate information from one stage to the other. The industry has to bet or to invest in technology and innovation. You can see that chart on the right. You can see that the construction industry is the one with the lowest index of digitalization. If we compare it to other industries, the construction is last in regards of digitalization. And this has an effect in the growth of productivity. But this chart should not let us down. It should fuel our interest in proposing improvements. We also need to work in changing or in beating the resistance to change. Many times, something that impedes the adoption of this methodology is the resistance Before I finish, I'd like to share my screen and show you just one example of what you can accomplish with this methodology. This is a software called Navisworks, and in this software you can simulate the construction process. So here you're going to see a building that I have divided in sectors, and you can see the construction sequence of the building. So being able to watch or to see this before the project is built is a really big advantage, not just for the contractor or the designer, but also for the client. The client is able to see what the project is going to consist and how the project is going to be built. I hope you have found this information useful. Thanks.
Super valiosa la información.
Thank you, Karen. The information you have provided is really valuable, showing us the state of the current state as well as the future of the state of the industry. These presentations allows or explain us more about this methodology and why it is really important for the construction sector.
Gracias, Karen. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Karen. Next. We're going to begin our third presentation called The Importance of BIM and the New Academic Challenges. This is architect Stephanie Mercado. Thanks for the opportunity.
Completa. Sí, gracias. Entonces, yo le voy a hablar un poco de los desafíos.
I'm going to talk about the challenges that we have as a country facing BIM. So my colleagues have already talked a bit about this. But I am going to set the context. So I'm going to start by talking about the characteristics of the construction sector worldwide. So worldwide, construction represents 13% of the GDP. But we can see that the growth of the construction sector productivity has been of 1% in the last 20 years. As Karen mentioned, a study made up by McKinsey in 2017 shows us the relation between the productivity growth and the digitization index. As you see, the construction industry appears in the last position. We can see that this is the main problems in our industry. Another problem is productivity. I show you a graphic that compares our industry with the manufacturing industry. As you can see, if we compare the hourly rate of our industry with the manufacturing industry, there's a difference of 2.6%. Despite that, in this graphic by the World Bank, you can see that there's an increase of the construction industry spending. Well, this graphic doesn't consider the reality that we have experienced since last year, but we can see that there's a favorable expectancy. And talking about the local scale, we have this data. There is a gap in our sector. In Peru, 455,000 houses or families do not have a house. 16,000 of them are in rural areas. We also have that 143,000 new houses are required every year. We have a sectoral housing. We need social housing that is accessible for everybody. And that's a challenge for us, for engineers and architects. Following with these issues, we can see that 69% of the houses in Peru have built their properties without a construction license. Meanwhile, 21% of them do have the construction license. This is because usually when they build or when someone builds their house, they don't use the services of an architect or a civil engineer. They only, or they usually take the services of technical labor or workforce. But that also leads to problems in habitability and the quality of the construction. Other relevant data is that 92% of the project, I think that the information is insufficient to build. And this is in regards of the business case for every project. As you can see, the vast majority of the business cases are seen as incomplete. 90% of the projects end up with over cost of more than 10%. Sadly, this is a reality in our country, and we are used to this. 95% of the project do not finish on the deadline. And that's just a consequence of the first two facts. And lastly, 37% of the materials of the construction industry end up being waste. Some researchers in the industry are trying to find out ways to use this waste, but it would be better if they were not produced. Some particular characteristics of our industry is the fragmentation, as has been explained. Also the unfulfillment of costs and deadlines, and mainly the absence of formality and the corruption experience in our countries, Latin American countries, is one of the main issues, one of the main reasons or causes for problems in the projects.
Y bueno, por último, y no menos importante, es la corrupción o la estima que tenemos actualmente en toda Latinoamérica con todo lo que ya sabemos de estos escándalos internacionales. Bueno, en cuanto a los desafíos de la construcción como sector en el Perú, voy a mencionar brevemente el estudio que hizo el ingeniero Daniel.
We are also facing some challenges in Peru. In 2010, or since 2010, there's register of the use of the BIM methodology in Peru. But from 2010 to 2017, the level of adoption has been of 24.5%. And from 2017 to 2020, the use of BIM has increased in almost 15%. So we can see that in these last 10 years, we have achieved a use of around 40%. As you can see, in 2017, 24.5% of the project used the BIM methodology, and in 2020, that percentage has risen to almost 40%. The use of new technology, is just an example of how new methodologies or new technologies are adopted. So the study, the 2017 study, shows that at least in Lima and Callao, the level of adoption is that of the early majority. But in Arequipa, we are in the stage of early adopters, which is a great step considering the fast level of adoption of this methodology. In another graphic, we can see, or we can compare, which disciplines are modeled in BIM. As you can see, the discipline of architecture has been leading the modeling, but also the structure discipline is also increasing its presence in the digital models, but mainly in the concrete structures. We talk about the steel structures. There's only a 54% of projects that include this information, but that's double the number that was used in the first poll.
En el Perú, tenemos que, como primer reto, tenemos que generar una conciencia de cambio, y esto viene desde
el plan. If we talk about the challenges in Peru, well, the first of them might be that we need to create change consciousness. We need that project managers in different organizations involve everybody in the organization in the BIM methodology. There's also a big responsibility for the academia to incorporate the BIM methodology in their curriculum. By doing this, they can have a great competitive advantage in comparison with other institutions that do not do this. Another challenge is having national standards adapted to our context and needs. And I mean exactly the BIM execution plan. As I showed you in the previous graphic, the progress of adapting and adopting these standards must be progressive, gradual. As we see, the adoption of the BIM methodology is just starting. So it's really important to adjust this to our reality. Another challenge is adapting a legal framework. This will allow the use of these tools for the development of the BIM methodology. We also must encourage the progressive adoption of the methodology in our organizations.
Sí es necesario, ¿no? De repente un proyecto de gran envergadura, sí es necesario un nivel de desarrollo de 400, porque sí
necesitamos. We also have to explain and understand the basic concepts of the methodology, such as the load or the level of development or level of detail. I have a clear grasp of them. Another challenge is that we have to work hand on hand, the private, the public sector, as well as the academia, in the implementation and incorporation of the BIM methodology nationwide. We must work, or we must use this methodology along with other principles or methods such as lean construction or BDC. And the last challenge that I can identify is the need to generate alliances for the diffusion and support for the communication actions and implementation of this methodology. To sum up, building information modeling is a disruptive technology, and it has come to change the way we work. We need to move from a fragmented or fragmented industry to a collaborative one. Using this methodology will give us or will get us access to more benefits along the life cycle of the project, not just the construction, but the design, as well as the operation and maintenance of the project. BIM has come to stay, and those who manage its early implementation will have a great competitive advantage in a sector where efficiency has not been their flagship. Thank you, Stephanie. Well, now we're going to have all our panelists so they can answer the questions that the participants may ask. So to begin, I'd like to ask you, how is it that you started in this methodology? How did you start to understand what this methodology meant? Maybe Cecilia, you'd like to answer. I finished the university in 2004. I used to draw by hand, and I also use AutoCAD. After that, I had experience in construction projects, but one day I attended a presentation like this one 5 years ago, and this really called my attention. So I realized how this methodology was going to be the future, or was already the present of the industry, and how in other countries this was already happening, but here we were just experiencing the beginning. And that's why I opted to follow a master program in this methodology. It cost me a lot. It cost me to learn how to use the software. But the road was easy to transit. It was very interesting. And one of the benefits is that you can do everything from the comfort of your house. Yeah, you have to invest a bit of improving your hardware and getting prepared for this stage.
Ser profesional como freelancer, a colaborar con otras instituciones también educativas, a colaborar con otros colegas en sus empresas, como consultorías. Yo creo que eso es el resultado de la experiencia desde la cátedra, ¿no? Y como le digo a los chicos cuando dicto la clase, tanto en la universidad, en las universidades, les digo, chicos, o sea, no es broma, esto es un presupuesto real, estudiar este programa es caro.
I always tell my students that studying or gaining skills in BIM usually means investing your time, investing money in your preparation, but you have to do it. No. That's already the present of our industry, and you have to gain these skills in order to be competitive. And I think it's really important to have these kind of presentations, because with a presentation like this, I started my own road in BIM. Karen, what about you? Well, I started with this in 2011, when there was almost nothing in Peru. And it was because of a project in the company that I was working at the time. Ever since, I've been involved in the BIM methodology. I also took a master course in BIM. This has motivated me to incur in research in BIM. I'm working with my studies in research and trying to find possible solutions to the issues that we find usually in projects, not just with Revit, but with other platforms that grant interoperability. Because the problem with native software is that, for example, you are not able to save your progress in an older version of the program. That means that you will have, or you will face the need of invest money in upgrade the versions every year. So my investigation revolves around OpenBIM, around being able to give access to the information to a wider group of people. So the work is really collaborative. Those involved in the construction sector have still a long way to work. There's a lot of professionals that still work with CAD, and we need to find a way to involve them in this methodology. And maybe one of the ways to do this is by giving them access software free of charge. That's my motivation. That's why I follow this line of investigation. It's really interesting to see that this also covers research. Stephanie, what about you? I also work with the traditional methodology. And realized that the latency was really high when you try to share information with that methodology. And so in the place I was working in, they asked me to start learning about BIM in order to implement it in the projects of the company. And that's how I found that being able to coordinate the information generated by the architect and the civil engineer really catched my attention.
De este mundo de la construcción, tienen sus profesiones de arquitectura e ingeniería civil. ¿Qué retos han encontrado en estudiar y utilizar esta metodología, ¿no? No sé si el hecho de ser mujeres han ayudado de alguna forma a que tienen ciertas habilidades blandas que las ha ayudado a aplicar
BIM,
eso.
BIM, demands or revolves around the use of soft skills. Do you think that being a woman helps you or makes a difference in trying to use the methodology? Actually, the company I was working in really moved me or stimulated me to use this methodology when not many companies use it. So I feel that this methodology won't really make differences between men or women. I think that the idea of behind the methodology is to make it accessible for everybody. Because in a project, we work with different stakeholders, and the challenge is in oneself. Maybe in a project, we will have colleagues that still don't know how to use, or maybe are not yet familiar to the methodology, but we must be able to work with them. I think that if you don't want to see relegated or to be relegated in the market, you must start investing time and resources in gaining skills and in learning about them. So I think that regardless of being men or women, you have to invest in this. I share Karen's opinion. The challenge is always in trying to stay or to update our knowledge. I think that women in construction have been exposed to work on site, and maybe the use of this methodology, and not only this one, but also lean construction and IPD, gives us an advantage, not only as women. And I cannot stress enough the importance of continuous learning. I share the opinion of my colleagues. When I talk to my students, they usually say that after we finish university, we will not study anymore, but I tell them that that's not the way things are. You must be continuously learning. There's always going to be something new. And we must be up to date with those, with that knowledge. I think this is for everybody, not just women. But I can also see the how it can be useful for people that they need to work from their houses, because by using this methodology, you can just work in the computer and share your information with the people working on site. So maybe this is an advantage, not by the point of view of a woman, but for just for anybody that may not be able to visit the site. And in this context, well, we have seen the usefulness of the methodology, because it allows us to work remotely. And you can see that it works. You don't need to be on the side. Because of the pandemic, we couldn't get together physically, but we could also, but the methodology allowed us to meet online and to work on the same project any time of the day. So for me, that's a big advantage. I repeat, for everybody, women, men, the only issue I can find may be the difference in times, difference in times around the world. I have worked with persons in Bolivia, Colombia, España, Spain, also with colleagues in different cities in Peru, and it has proved to be a really good, really powerful tool.
Ya Karen nos ha respondido. No sé si quieran complementar algo más sobre esa pregunta. Justo ahí, bueno, Karen nos dice que la certificación de esta norma a la fecha no se ha planteado como requisito, ¿no? Lo que sí requisito es implementar esa guía y formatos del Plan BIM del Perú para proyectos públicos. Muy bien. Y bueno, finalmente, no sé si quieran dejar un mensaje a todos los participantes.
Finally, maybe you'd like to leave a message for the assistants. It has been a privilege to have you as presenters.
Que el que tenemos que seguir. Entonces, no sé si quieran dejar un mensaje. Stephanie, comenzamos contigo.
What about you, Stephanie? Would you like to leave a message? As I told you, one of the biggest challenges in our country, in the education and in this methodology, is that I believe that the academia has to implement this methodology, not just in the private university, but also in the public ones. For example, the material takeoff and the creation of schedules is much easier with BIM tools. So I think the time to learn about these methodologies now. Karen, would you like to leave a message? Once again, I thank you. I thank the university for the invitation. I thank everybody that has assisted to the presentation. I consider that not having the resources because of the times that we are living, it's not an excuse to not being able to learn something new. There are a lot of offers to learn online. There are some really good subjects on the internet. I think it depends on the curiosity that you have to learn and investigate. You don't need to pay for an expensive subject. You can form your own knowledge, and that's an advantage that now, or that everybody has now. When I was a student, I didn't have that opportunity, but now the information is everywhere, and you need to use this advantage to train yourselves. Maybe with time you can also enroll in a master program, but meanwhile there's a lot of information you can find. There's a lot of papers and research results that you can consult. So I think that, again, and I must repeat it, we are the main responsibles for our learning of this methodology. Thank you, Karen. Let me tell you that studying in our university also have subjects that expose them to the BIM methodology. So they have taken the first step, but I think what you have said is really important, and it's something that we are missing. And it is linking these subjects to the rest of the subjects that we teach. What about you, Cecilia? Well, I think that you should always be motivated to learn about not just this methodology, but any new trend in the industry. You have to be curious, because every year there's new software. And not only paid software or paid alternatives, you can also find some free options online. And also for the students that have the access to these subjects in the university, please make a good use of them. You will see that this methodology is linked and has an application in mostly all of the courses or the subjects that you take. They are all related. So please always be motivated to continuously learn new things, to create new things, to try new methods, to question everything, and also to find out and have a real notion on what can I learn from this methodology. Thank you, Cecilia. We have one last question, and it's from Carlos Ceballos. He says, I'd like to know how workers in construction, not just the professionals, such as architects and civil engineers, how do the workers can use this methodology? Would they be able to use this methodology? Are there any offers for them? Yeah, there are some experiences for where workers in a project that are not professionals, that haven't been through the university, they can also use these models. And to do that, we usually use tablets that show the 3D model and have an interface adjusted to the information that the worker needs to use in order to, or needs to know in order to use the model. So there are some options. There are levels of application for this methodology. So in that project, where I showed this worker the 3D model in the tablet, after it finished, he asked me, how can I learn about this? He was really curious about this. And when we had our meetings in the project, he was really excited about how the information was shown.
Le toca usted ya solitarse, no importa si tiene 50 años, ya le toca entrar.
And I told him that, well, it's up to you to learn how to use the methodology. But I think that the motivation is key. It's really important. So, or really important for the adoption of the methodology. I think it's all about motivation.
Sí, quisiera hacer algo y si me permiten les comparto un ejemplo de un software que podría usarlo y que no es necesario que sean expertos en el manejo. A ver.
Let me show you a software that maybe someone that doesn't have many or much formation in the methodology. I showed you this program that is called BIM Collapse Zoom. And it's a software not for creating information, but just for watching it, for viewing it. So you don't really know, or you don't really need to have skills in modeling. You don't really need to know how to create this information in Revit, but you can use the model. you can take a look around, you can see the different components. Mm-hmm. So this kind of software could be a good alternative for those that do not have a set of skills yet, but are interested in the methodology. It shows information in a really simple interface.
Y las felicitamos a ustedes por ya ser parte de este cambio y también transmitirlo, ¿no? Porque las tres se dedican a la docencia. Así que felicitaciones y muchas gracias.
Well, thanks for the three panelists. We have reached the end of the presentation, Introduction to the Build Information Model. Building Information Modeling in Peru, Perspectives in the Construction Sector in Peru. This was organized by the Universidad Católica San Pablo, the University of Newcastle in Australia, the Pontificia Universidad Javeriana de Bogotá, and the Universidad Católica del Norte de Chile, all members of the COALER project. We thank you for your presence. Good night.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias.